Hi, in this segment, we'll begin looking at the coding template for the second coding assignment, which is homework 3. All right, so to begin with, let's look at the source file, main.cc. All right, and I've actually included two sets. We have of source files and header files. We have source files and header files for the 2D problem and for the 3D problem, okay? So let's look at the 2D problem first. You can see it's basically the same structure as the previous homework assignment. One difference is that now I'm setting the dimension equal to 2, which we're then inputting as the template parameter for our finite element method class. The other difference is that when we're generating the mesh, instead of passing in a single integer, since it's 2D, we're passing in a vector with two integers that defines the number of elements in each direction. So here, the name of the vector is num of elements. And for an example, I've set up 4 elements in the x direction and 8 elements in the y direction, a 4x8 element mesh. Of course, you can change that as you're doing your programming, but that's the setup. Okay, other than that, it's pretty much the same. We have generate mesh, setup system, assemble system, solve and output results. We aren't calculating the L2 norm of these problems. It's just, you can do it for a 2D problem if you have the exact solution. However, for the problems we give you, we aren't giving you the exact solutions as well. So you don't need to bother calculating the L2 norm. If you did, however, you would still be able to look at the rate of convergence as you increase the number of elements. Another difference, or two other differences, are that in this case, our constructor for problem object, for our finite element class, we don't have any constructor. We don't have any inputs to the constructor because we're only doing linear basis functions, so we don't have to input the Lagrangian function order. And since I've already split up the problem into a 2D and a 3D problem, there aren't any further sub-problems after that. There's only one 2D problem and one 3D problem in this homework assignment. So there are no inputs to the constructor. Okay, so let's go over to the template. This is FEM homework 3A template. We have the same header files here, again using namespace DL2. And if we scroll down to the declaration of the functions and objects, let's look at that. All right. You'll notice that I didn't include the function xiet node, whatever, because since we're doing linear basis functions, it's a lot easier to keep track of what the value of xi is at whatever node you happen to be at, okay? So I deleted that. If it was useful to you, you're free to go ahead and write such a function yourself. Now let's look at basis function and basis gradient. There are a couple differences here. First off, we have more inputs. We still have the node number, but now we have xi1 and xi2. Obviously we have two coordinates since it's a 2D problem. Also with basis gradient, instead of returning just a double, since we are 2D, the gradient is a 2D vector, and so I'm returning a standard vector of doubles. Okay. The solution steps, however, are the same. Generate mesh, define boundary conditions, set up system, assemble system, solve and output results. Except, of course, that generate mesh accepts as an input a vector of integers instead of just a single integer. The DL2 class objects are the same. The Gaussian quadrature rule is the same. All the data structures and solution names, those are all the same from in this assignment. All right, so let's scroll down here to the constructor. Again, we still have the same method of calling the constructor of our class variables, FE and DOF handler, just as before. But since we don't have problem and order as an input, we don't need to worry about storing those. We have the same destructor as before as well. All right. Moving on to the basis function and the basis gradient. Again, we talked about the differences in input, where I have node xi1 and xi2 now. But you'll still do it in the same way. Probably in this case, it wouldn't make sense to do a generalized function, although you can certainly go ahead and do that. Since it's a lot simpler, since we're just doing linear basis functions and there are fewer, and so we don't necessarily have so many nodes as before, you can just do a simple if statements. You know, if node equals such and such, evaluate the basis function using C1 and C2. All right, and then again, you'll return value. Similar with basis gradient, you notice here I've already, when I declared this standard vector values, which is what will be returned, I've already set up the length or the size of values to be dim. Of course, dim we define in main.cc, we've defined it to be 2 in this case. So this creates a vector of length 2. I've initialized the contents to be 0. Of course, they would have been 0 automatically anyway. But you'll need to go ahead and evaluate the basis gradients at the given nodes for both components of this gradient vector. All right. In some ways, simpler than before because we're only dealing with linear basis functions, or rather bilinear basis functions, I should say, since it's 2D. But of course, since they are in two directions, that is something else for you to consider. All right. Oh, at this point, I should point out that DL2, again, has some different node numbering from the class. All right, so let's go to the board here. In the class, or rather in the lectures, we went around the nodes. Since we're only dealing with bilinear, we only have nodes at the vertices here. But it was something like this, 1, 2, 3, 4. All right, in DL2, it's a little bit different. Again, as before, as with the linear case, we'll be starting at 0 in our numbering, but we're always going left to right. We go left to right, bottom to top. So 0, 1, and then up here it's 2, 3. Okay, so that's something for you to consider in your if statements. What would have been basis function 1 according to the lectures is now basis function 0 according to DL2. What would have been basis function 2 according to the lectures is now basis function 1 according to DL2, and so on. Okay. Okay, so in this case, remember we need to use the DL2 basis function node numbering, all right? Because we are using DL2's mesh, we're using DL2's connectivity matrices, and so on. So remember to use DL2's node numbering as you're creating your basis function and the gradients of the basis function. All right. So moving on to generate mesh. Again, it's very simple. There's not much for you to do. You just have to define the limits of your domain, the left and right and top and bottom. So x min, x max, y min, y max. And again, we'll use DL2's functions to create that mesh. So not a lot for you to edit there. And now we come to define boundary conditions. Again, this is defining the Dirichlet boundary conditions. In this homework 3, you won't have any Neumann boundary conditions. And we actually don't even have a forcing function or a body force at all. In this case, a forcing function since it's a temperature problem. And so these Dirichlet boundary conditions are the only boundary conditions we're applying. Of course, there are Neumann boundary conditions of 0, which we don't have to do anything about in our coding. Now you actually have to create this function yourself, but it's going to be very, very similar to the same function defined boundary conditions in the previous homework. All right? You'll be looping over all of your nodes, and you'll have an if statement to check to see what boundary you're on. Now the difference is that now you have both x and y coordinates, and so you'll need to check, in order to check what boundary you're on, you'll have to specify, are you checking the x value or the y value? The other difference comes in that node locations, whereas before it was a vector, now it's a table. Let me just go back up to the top. And so you can see table is a DL2 function, or a DL2 data object. And the 2 here just specifies that it's a two-dimensional table. All right. And it holds doubles. Okay. So let me just sketch out what that would look like. It's a two-dimensional table. The row index is going to be the global degree, the global node number. So it's just like the index in the vector of node location before. So this will go up to, just the largest node number, global node number. Okay, so that specifies which node you're at. The column just tells you which component of the position you're looking at you want to know. Really, it's telling you, do you want the x-coordinate or the y-coordinate? Okay, so for example, if this is our mesh, and I'm actually not exactly sure how DL2 does the global node numbering in 2D. So I'll just do it this way. But again, DL2 does it in a, may do it in a different way. So anytime you want the global node number, you'll actually need to use local DUF indices to go from a local to a global node number. But let's say the value here is, say this coordinate is 0, 0. And just for simplicity, I'll make this 1, 0, 2, 0. This would be 2, 1. This would be 2, 2. And so on. Okay, so this table over here would look like this. At node 0, the x-coordinate is 0, the y-coordinate is 0. At node 1, x is 1, y is 0. At node 2, x is 2. Y is 0 again. If we come down to node 5, for example, x is still 2, the y has a value of 1, and so on. Okay. So if I wanted the x coordinate at node 5, I would use node location. At node 5, if I wanted the x location, I would take 0. And then that would return to me 2. Okay. So again, this is the global node number. And the second component, the column number, is the component. Again, essentially x or y, or in the case of the 3D problem that we'll look at, z. Okay? All right. So with that, you should be able to fill in this defined boundary conditions function pretty well. Now let's stop there in this segment, and in the next segment, we'll move on to looking at setup system and assemble system.